This is Guardian Radio, your station for up-to-the-minute news, intelligent, interactive, and engaging conversation. 96.9 FM. The views and opinions of the hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Network.
Off the Record with Zhivargo Laing is sponsored by Royal Fidelity Bank and Trust, Burger King, Royal Star Assurance, Cable Bahamas, Rev Christmas, Atlantis Paradise Island, Mischief Health, AML Foods Limited, and BT.
Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. So glad you could join us here today on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM on this beautiful Thursday afternoon. I trust and hope that you are doing well. If you want to give us a call on the show today, the numbers to do so are as follow. You can call us on 323-6232. That's 323-6232 or 325-4316. 325-4316 or 325-4259. That's 325-4259. You can text us on 4224796. That's 4224796. Or you can WhatsApp us on me on 4393043. That's 4393043. We are, of course, live on Cable Bahamas, channel 969. That's the way my mother listens to the show. Or you can catch us on BTC Flow Channel 612. That's BTC Flow Channel 612. There seems to be some confusion about what is required to travel throughout the country under the new regulations. And according to the orders that have been issued, not now under the emergency powers, but under the provisions of the new health legislation, I want to just read what it says, what the order says, okay, for domestic travel. And thanks, this was supplied by someone who was concerned about it, who had been encountering the people with that difficulty. It says that a person who travels into Ireland as a passenger in any aircraft or from an island listed in the schedule, any aircraft or seacraft, I believe that should be because the whole thing didn't come, says that, that person is going to have to produce before embarkation on that aircraft or vessel, A, if he is fully vaccinated, the negative results of a rapid antigen or RT-PCR test. So either one of those can be presented if the results are negative, if you are fully vaccinated. B, if he is not fully vaccinated, the negative results of an RT-PCR test. So if you are not vaccinated and you are traveling into Ireland, then you are supposed to be, and this is for this is only for islands listed in the second schedule. This is not for all islands. And says you also have to produce, all you have to do is produce proof of exemption from the requirements above, right? So that seems to be the case for inter-island travel. All right. I don't know why people are being confused about it. I have to admit needs a little more fuller information. But anyhow, if you're out there and you got the better, fuller information, you know, send it to us. We'll help you out. Before you travel, ask your airline man, please. That's probably the best thing to do so you can avoid some of the confusion that people seem to be having now. I don't know why we should be confused at this point with these things, but we can be confused because unfortunately, information is not going out as smoothly as is necessary. That's the challenge, right? And so we need to do a better job at that. You know, the reality is we are acting as if the pandemic is over. Yes, we have these rules and people are getting comfortable to the extent that they're getting comfortable with it now and quote, we're living with COVID, but there's still a pandemic in the world. There's still a pandemic at work in the Bahamas. And so the health professionals, the health authorities have to keep acting as if there is one. Now, we get these, these commercials that are being these public, what do you call it, public announcements or public information commercials that are coming on. And they are telling and continuing to encourage people to be careful, but there are other pieces of information people could benefit from that may benefit from having some regular presentations too. And maybe the people who are responsible for putting that information out might want to take account of that. Okay, so we continue to have a lot of people unemployed. Is that true or not true? We don't have a lot of people unemployed still? Or is everybody back to work now? No, we got thousands of people unemployed in the Commonwealth of the Bahamas. We have thousands of people yet underemployed in the Commonwealth of the Bahamas. And in addition to that, we got now companies being asked to make a decision about whether or not the folks they have on furlough are either going to be terminated or returned to work or what. There's a lot of unemployment in the country. You know what that unemployment means, right? You know what that underemployment means, right? It means that if you have bills, and everybody does, who is an adult in this country, if you have bills, if you don't have any income coming in, then you know the stress that that is causing. You know the challenge that that is producing. Your children need to be cared for. Your rent or mortgage needs to be paid. The groceries need to be bought. Things need to be repaired and fixed. It piles on and it's a buggy load of stress. If you've got a business and your income has dwindled, you've got payrolls to meet, you've got utilities to meet, you've got all kinds of things that have to be met. And that creates challenges. And when you have no income and you can't lean on anybody, then you got to lean on the government. And then the government has to find that money. And if the government has to find that money and doesn't have enough money coming in, the government's going to incur a deficit. That deficit is going to compound and the national debt is going to continue to rise. And at some point, they're going to come back to dip into the pockets of the people to say, we got to pay these monies because we got this issue. Where am I going with this? Right, all this because of the pandemic and other issues in the country. It is an absolute untruth that the only thing that has created economic challenges for the Commonwealth of the Bahamas is the pandemic or Dorian. That is absolutely untrue. The Commonwealth of the Bahamas had economic challenges before Dorian and before the pandemic. We've got a total factor productivity in this country that simply has been declining, not increasing, and that has caused us not to be able to have our economy moving at the level that it needs to be moved at. And that total factor productivity is a function of the skillfulness, the knowledge base, the work ethic of the labor pool in the country, the labor force of the country. All right, so we've had that as a problem in the country. We've had in the country issues around the efficiencies of our operations and the way we approach things and so forth. And that has caused a dwindling of our economic progress in the country. So we had issues long before the pandemic, long before, right? But the pandemic and Dorian made these things abundantly worse, abundantly worse. And I'm telling you that the economic hardship is weighing so hard on people in this country. You've got people walking around, moving around the Commonwealth of the Bahamas today who are dazed. You hear me? They are dazed. They are winded to meet the obligations that are staring them in the face. And it is putting a monumental weight on relationships in this country of all types. Husbands and wives, parents and children, partners and partners, neighbors and neighbors, because people are stressed out. And to some degree, some people can't even figure out why in the world am I really as stressed out as I am? And what kind of nonsense is going on? Right? Because of the weight of the economic challenge that is facing far too many people in this country. Now, the way out of the economic challenge is economic growth. Growth that produces jobs. You heard me correctly. Jobs. All these highfalutin folk who like to talk about, oh, we only trying to create jobs for people instead of creating owners. You are speaking in absolute ignorance when you say something like that. Absolute ignorance. Because behind every job is a business.
So when you create jobs, you have automatically acknowledged the existence of an enterprise that has created the job. So it is an ignorant statement, meaning not fully knowing or appreciating the totality of the economic realities behind something that you say we are only in about the business of creating jobs. The fact of the matter is the vast majority of people in the Commonwealth of the Bahamas who aspire to take care of themselves, take care of their families, take care of their neighborhood, they will do it by way of a job, and it would be the most ridiculous and the most incompetent government in the world to walk around thinking, what I need to do is go ahead and make everybody an owner. Ridiculous, absolute ridiculous. People need jobs. So we need an economy that is moving to create thousands of jobs. With income that is capable of helping people meet their daily obligations. Behind all those thousands of jobs will be hundreds of businesses, entrepreneurs who put their capital to work in order to meet, to provide certain products and services that they require workers to be able to help them do. So it's a virtuous integration of things that happen when you create jobs. Okay, so we have to have the economy do that. Now, the economy is not going to do that and create the jobs, create the income, which by its very nature means you're creating businesses without capital investment. What do I mean by capital investment? I mean, you gotta finance the startup of the job, the enterprise, the business. You have to finance, you have to have money to expand a business. Where is the money going to come from? Some of it is going to come from Bahamians who have saved up their money, who have pooled their money, and who say, together, we're going to start this business and create this opportunity. Some of it is going to come from there. Listen, I am accustomed to some of you, not all of you, not many of you even. I'm accustomed to some of you sitting down there listening to us and listening to me start talking nonsense, but oh, Laing them just don't believe in Bahamians and don't believe in this. Listen, with the greatest respect to you, the vast majority of capital investment in this country will not come from Bahamian sources. Will not, has never done so, and will not do so anytime soon. So we do need that capital to be at work, but the vast majority of people who hold money in this country are not going to plow it into this economy. And the ones who are going to do it and who are going to do it more will not do it until they get the catalyst of foreign investment taking place in the country and inducing economic growth. It will not happen that way until that happens. So we need a Bahamian capital, but oh, we need an abundance of foreign capital. And that leads me to the discussion I will have today about an article that a friend of mine sent me. And it was in some of the dailies recently too, at least comments about it was in the daily. And the article is entitled, A Strategic Challenge for the US, China, and the Bahamas. Imagine that. This is an article that was featured in The Hill. This is a Washington-based publication. And the article is entitled, A Strategic Challenge for the U.S. Listen to that now. The most powerful, the most wealthy country in the world has a strategic challenge. And what is that strategic challenge, according to these authors? China and the Bahamas. And this was written by Patrick J. Griffin and William Danvers. This was an opinion piece that they wrote for The Hill. We're going to take a break, and when we come back, I'm going to tell you who they are, and then I'm going to read the article for you, so you can know what they are saying about this strategic challenge. You're listening to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. We'll be back after this break.
Are working to protect our country, our people, and our livelihoods so that we can move forward. The vaccine is safe. The vaccine is easy. The vaccine is essential for our recovery. If we want to rebuild our economy, if we want to get back to our jobs, if we want to get back to our lives, our families, we must do this together.
I ain't marched the car. The lady who run into me marched the car.
I hope she had insurance.
If she had insurance, she hop out, pull out her phone, pull up the Royal Star Assurance app, and bang, she was on a video call with an RSA rep, sending pictures of her damage, my damage, filing a claim on the spot.
For real? Our insurance have that kind of app?
You gotta go to RSA for that.
Download the RSA app today or visit rsabahamas.com to submit your claim online. Live chat available weekdays 9 to 5.
Rev customers already get more channels, more sports, and more speed. Now, we're giving more Christmas with up to $250,000 in cash and prizes. Sign up or upgrade to Rev Trio to win prizes like rent and mortgage payments, trips to see your favorite sports teams, plus up to $20,000 in our Rev Cash Vault. Want to win more Christmas? Call 601-8992 today and ask for Rev Trio. Rev, you and us together.
This is Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
I'm not afraid to take a stand. Everybody, come take my hand.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. So glad that you could join us here today on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM on this beautiful Thursday afternoon. We're talking about a strategic challenge for the USA. And that challenge, according to Patrick J. Griffin and William Danvers, is China and the Bahamas. Listen to me. China has a population of 1.4 billion people. 1.4 billion people. The Bahamas has a population of 389,000. All right, there is no comparison insofar as size, military power, and the like between the Bahamas and China. All right, China is 360 times the size of the Bahamas. China's gross domestic product compared to that of the Bahamas is $14.72 trillion. $14.72 trillion compared to the Bahamas is 12 or so billion dollars.
trillion. That's not nine zeros, that's billions, that's 12 zeros behind it, but making the China's economy 1,167 times the size of the Bahamas. All right, now, on a per capita, if you look at the GDP per capita, the Bahamas is actually ahead of China in that regard. China's GDP per capita is $10,400. $10,400. The Bahamas' GDP per capita stands at about $28,000, $29,000. So to that extent, the Bahamas doubles China's GDP per capita. So there's not too many circumstances in which China and the Bahamas would be used in the same breath. We don't share the same political ideology. It is only in recent times that China has embraced capitalism the way the Bahamas has always embraced it. We have very different cultures, but even though we, you know, Bahamians love Chinese food, and we do have a segment of a Chinese population in the country, but there are not too many circumstances in which we would be mentioned in the same breath, most especially as a strategic challenge to the U.S. of A. Strategic challenge meaning that, because sometimes we use this word strategy and lots of people not sure what a strategy is. A strategy really is a set of decisions that have to be made to achieve a certain outcome, to win at something, right? So what are those decisions that have to be made to lead you to achieving something that you have decided you want to achieve? So what these authors are saying is for the United States of America to achieve a certain outcome that the country requires, they have to pay attention to and make some decisions in regard to China and the Bahamas. So let's see what they have to say. Griffin, let me tell you so you know the background of these people doing the writing. Patrick Griffin is a professor at American University. That's there in Washington, D.C. I used to work at the Bahamas Embassy, and it's not too far from American University. And he worked as an assistant to President Clinton and was secretary to the Democratic Conference in the U.S. Senate. William Danvers is an adjunct professor at George Washington University. I studied my MBA at George Washington University for a year and a half. He's at the Elliott School there, and he worked on national security issues for the Clinton and the Obama administration. So these are folks who have been in the know and high up in the government of the United States of America, and they are also mostly on the Democratic side of things. So here's what they say. A primary focus of the Biden administration's national security policy has been the great power relationship between the United States and the People's Republic of China. That relationship is multifaceted. As Harvard professor and former Defense Department official Joseph Nye points out in a New York Times article, end quote, competition with China is a three-dimensional game. And if we continue to play two-dimensional chess, we will lose, end quote. Nye's three dimensions are military, economic, and the social. But there is an important subset to the three. And they say that subset is regional concerns. Says the PRC, which is the People's Republic of China, activity in the Bahamas is an example of the three dimensions plus regional activity coalescing in a direct challenge to U.S. interests. This challenge is not theoretical, it is existential. Listen to me now, these guys are using very heavy language to describe what they regard as a challenge to the United States. The word existential means
having to do with your very existence. Very existence. You listen, man. That, in other words, listen, you don't get this right, it could cost you totally. Says a recent article in the Bahamian paper, the Nassau Guardian, lays it out clearly. Listen to me now, these are the guys, they're writing up there in Washington. Reading your Nassau Guardian. I keep telling y'all, y'all stay right there. People be reading from around the world the stuff you be saying about yourself. It says, end quote, Deputy Prime Minister and Minister of Tourism, Investments and Aviation, Chester Cooper, is inviting Chinese investors to take advantage of opportunities in the tourism, agriculture, and renewable energy sectors, and to partner with the government on projects such as the upcoming public-private partnership airport redevelopment project, end quote. They go on to say, specifically over the past dozen years, China has made a number of investments in the Bahamas, including a $30 million grant to build a national stadium, preferential loans to build a $3 billion megaport at Freeport. I don't know what that's about. I don't know that leak I seen them on the container port. And I don't know that the container port is a $3 billion investment. And I certainly don't think they used any Chinese money other than Li Ka-shing's money to do it, unless you say that's one and the same. But they go on to say on $40 million to build a port off the Bahamian island of Abaco. Further, the Chinese Exim Bank provided over $54 million in preferential loans to build a four-lane highway and loaned nearly $3 billion to build a Bahama resort. The resort is right. I think the loan on the highway was about $80 million. Says the China State Engineering Corporation purchased the British Hilton Colonial as part of a $250 million construction project. They go on to say PRC involvement in the Bahamas is not simply about its willingness to invest in the island nation. It is focused on moving the Bahamas. Listen to this now. That the PRC is focused on moving the Bahamas away from the U.S. and toward China. Because of recent crises, the Bahamas, a longtime U.S. ally, is more vulnerable to PRC overtures. The Bahamas was devastated in 2019 by Hurricane Dorian. The Inter-American Development Bank estimates that the hurricane cost the Bahamas $3.4 billion, approximately one-fourth of its GDP. Adding economic insult to injury, the World Bank estimates that the COVID-19 pandemic caused an economic contraction of approximately 16.2% in 2020. In addition, unemployment and poverty levels increased as a result of these two crises. It is worth noting that, according to the U.S. State Department, despite its World Bank designation as a high-income country, income inequality is higher in the Bahamas than in other Caribbean countries. There are also strategic considerations for the U.S. with the Bahamas. For example, the Coast Guard has been working with the Bahamas and the Turks and Caicos for a number of years on a program countering the flow of drugs through the region. The Navy has a submarine testing center in the Bahamas. The U.S. government this year gave $5.9 million in boats and communications equipment to the Royal Bahamas Defense Force. The Bahamian government has been supportive of U.S. policy toward Venezuela and Nicaragua at the United Nations and Organization of American States. Ladies and gentlemen, you're listening to Z Live. We're going to take a break, and then we're going to continue to look at this article that says that the United States of America faces a strategic issue, and that strategic issue is the Bahamas and China. We'll be back after this break.
Hello? Yes, it's time. I know, a lot sooner than we thought. Well, that's thanks to those returns from my RF Mutual funds. You know they have some of the best performing funds in the market. Yep. With what I've been earning, I can finally set a date for my product launch. Draft the paperwork. I'm on my way.
Reach your financial goals sooner with RF Mutual Funds. Sign up by November 29th for a chance to win $1,000. Find out more at rfgroup.com. RF, money at work.
With BTC Business's new smart solutions powered by super fast, reliable broadband, you'll feel like there are more versions of you working for you. From website design, development, and digital marketing to promote your business, 24/7 business class support to cloud solutions, security, and more. Multiply your growth today.
Food security is a challenge for many. Now in a pandemic, many more are unsure of their next meal. Through their Feed 5000 program and a $20,000 donation, AML is working to ensure that everyone has a meal for the holidays, and they're inviting you to help. Now until December 17th, visit any Solomon's, Costrite, Fresh Market, or Domino's in Nassau or Freeport, and Exuma Markets in Georgetown to donate and help feed a family in need this Christmas. No amount is too small. Remember, we're all in this together.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
I'm not afraid to take a stand, take a stand. Everybody, everybody, come take my hand, come take my hand. We'll walk this road together through the storm.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. So glad that you could join us here today on Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM on this beautiful Thursday afternoon. If you want to call, the numbers are 323-6232 or 325-4316 or 325-4259. You can also text us on 422-4796 or you can WhatsApp me on 439-3043. We're talking about an article written by two Americans in Washington, D.C., who are talking about a strategic issue that the United States of America faces, saying that that strategic issue is the Bahamas and China relationship. All right, and they go on in the article to say, the threat that China poses to U.S. interests in the Bahamas was not lost on General Glenn Van Herk, Commander, United States Northern Command and North American Aerospace Defense Command. In testimony before Congress this year, he stated, and I quote, China continues to pursue an aggressive geopolitical strategy that seeks to undermine U.S. influence around the globe and shape the international environment to its advantage. Listen to this now. This is a commander in the U.S. Army. And listen to what he says. In the U.S. NORTHCOM area of responsibility, China has made deliberate attempts to increase its economic and political influence with our close partners in Mexico and the Bahamas. Says the Biden administration has shown a consistent strategic effort to deal with the China challenge. In his recent European trip, President Biden lifted steel and aluminum tariffs that the previous administration imposed. As part of the arrangement, European Union exports would have to be entirely domestically manufactured with no inputs from China. There also was an agreement to restrict imports contingent on how much carbon is involved with their production, which would have an impact on China. Secretary of Commerce Gina Raimondo recently announced that the U.S. would work to use European and Asian supply chains rather than those of the People's Republic of China. This nuanced strategy to respond to the PRC global policies should include a specific response to that nation's engagement with the Bahamas. There are a few steps that would help let the Bahamas and other allies in the Caribbean and throughout Latin America know that the U.S. appreciates
the important role they play as neighbors and allies countering PRC outreach. USAID and the Development Finance Corporation can work with investors and aid donors to help the Bahamas to rebuild its economy. The IDB and the World Bank have the resources and expertise to complement U.S. bilateral economic engagement with the Bahamas. As General Van Herk pointed out, the U.S. has strategic issues it must consider with respect to the Bahamas, must consider. Increased engagement with the RBDF, as well as increased drug interdiction engagement, would help strengthen the military side of the U.S. ledger. Says tourism is a primary source of income and job creation for the Bahamas. The Department of Commerce in particular should work with the Bahamian government to rebuild this essential part of its economy in the wake of Hurricane Dorian and the pandemic. Emphasizing creative approaches such as ecotourism could help with this undertaking. It has been over a decade since the U.S. has had an ambassador in the Bahamas. This sends a negative signal that the relationship is not important to the U.S., playing into the hands of China. The U.S. needs an ambassador who is not only knows the Bahamas, but also understands the complicated political environment of Washington. And those in the Senate holding up nominations must cease and desist. Our national security is at stake. Says the Biden administration has an opportunity to continue with its policy toward the PRC by engaging the Bahamas as a counter to China's efforts to expand its influence in the backyard of the USA. Yeah, very interesting. Now, they are obviously speaking from the perspective of the US. And what they are saying in speaking from the perspective of the US is, isn't the Bahamas might be small, but it's strategically important to you. They say we are on the US's back door. That's from the US perspective. And they are saying, what I like about what they're saying is they're saying, we're not telling you to tell the Bahamas to stop engaging with China. We're telling you to make the U.S. presence and involvement and engagement with China and the Bahamas more robust so that the Bahamas might in turn not feel itself so needing so much from China. That's what essentially they are saying. Now, if I were entitling this article from the Bahamas perspective, it would be a strategic challenge for the Bahamas, colon, the USA and the China. That's how I would put it. I wouldn't say that the Bahamas is in the US's back door. I would say that the US is in the Bahamas's front door. Right? So that's from our perspective. But again, the points that they make is quite valid. Is valid. What they are doing is something that we don't even do pretty much ourselves. That our strategic location in respect of the US and all the region is something of a critical military economic value. It is. And that because of it, it is not possible to simply ignore what happens in the Bahamas, what happens to the Bahamas. And what they are saying is, recognize that the vulnerability of the Bahamas is this economic situation. That's what I just finished telling you guys. We are in a vulnerable economic situation. We need jobs. We need jobs. We need jobs. Those jobs come because businesses come. Those businesses come because capital investments come. Those capital investments come from Bahamian, but mostly international sources as a catalyst for economic growth. And they're saying the U.S. has to use its tentacles, use its avenues, use its agencies to do something about this economic vulnerability that the Bahamas has. Now, if I were writing the article from the Bahamas' point of view, as opposed to seeing ourselves as a basket case and charity case for the U.S., I would say the Bahamas government has to see that there is a strategic working partnership that could be struck with the United States of America that could bring about mutual benefits for the United States and ourselves. That using this tension, this dis-ease that they have about the Chinese involvement in the Bahamas can make us more attractive and a compelling discussion in respect of what can we do going forward to improve the condition and circumstances of both our countries. So I agree with them on that. But what I'm saying is, let they see it as the U.S., you need to go do something for the Bahamas. I'm saying, let's see it as, let's sit down with the United States of America and let's talk strategic shock for the country. And I'm talking about strategic shock. Now, when I come back from the news break, I'm going to talk about some very heavy strategic shock that some of you may not agree with me. And hey, boo, no problem. No problem. I'd love to hear your thoughts about it too. No problem. You may disagree. So you could launch your stuff forward. But the Bahamas, like many micro states, like many small states, have some long-term decisions to make about its viability, prosperity, and continuing development. Some very strategic decisions. And it means in that strategic decisions, thinking about some fundamental ways we have thought about ourselves that could really be game changers for us. I'm talking about some profoundly different ways of thinking about ourselves. Because this issue is not going away. China is not going away. The U.S. cannot wish away China. China is going to continue to build in strength in the global marketplace and in the global political space. China is going to continue to be a compelling force. Maybe, perhaps, some might argue the greatest force. And so is India at some point going to factor into that discussion as well. And there is going to be no ignoring their capacity to be influential and impactful on countries, especially developing small country, island countries like ourselves. But the U.S. ain't going away either. And with the right leadership, the U.S. is only going to get stronger and better. And so these two giants are going to be before us for a long time. And we have decisions to make about that. Apparently, the brave Davis administration has already made that decision. Listen to me. The deputy prime minister went out there and said, come China. I'm going to talk about how he should have added to that when we come back. You're listening to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. We're going to take a break from news. We'll be back after this break.
I'm not afraid. I'm not afraid to take a stand. Everybody, come take my hand. We'll walk this road together through the storm. Whatever weather, cold or warm, let you know that you're not alone. Holler if you feel like you've been down the same road.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. So glad you could join us here today on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM on this beautiful Thursday afternoon. If you want to weigh in today, the numbers to call are 323-6232 or 325-4316 or 325-4259. You can also text at 422-4796. That's 422-4796. You can WhatsApp me on 439-3043. Talking about an article written about the strategic issue that confronts the United States of America, in that the article argues China's growing influence in the Bahamas poses a threat to U.S. interest in the Bahamas. And why does the U.S. have an interest in the Bahamas? Well, it has an interest because if somebody sets up any kind of military presence, any kind of commercial presence of any great worth in your, in quote, back door, that could pose a vulnerability to you as a territory. And the Bahamas has at its front door the United States of America, or you might argue at its back door, the United States of America, you could argue, depends on your perspective. So what China and others do here matters, the argument goes. Why is this important for us? It's important to us because there is no possibility that all those thousands of young people who are looking for work, looking for economic opportunity in the Bahamas, all those thousands of not so young people who are looking for work and economic opportunity in the Bahamas, are going to find it without substantial foreign investment in the country. It's not going to happen. And where's the foreign investment going to come from? Well, big players in the foreign direct investment business in the world are the United States of America and China. Europe plays a big role too, but not as big a role as the United States of America and China. And so if you're going to go out there and seek to get capital to grow your economy and develop your economy and provide jobs and provide prosperity for your people, you cannot take China and the United States out the picture. The problem is China and the United States are at odds with each other, competing with each other for influence in the world. They have different ideologies about life, political life. They have different views about certain social issues. And so the question is, what will you do? If Chinese investors want to come to the Bahamas to invest, what is the Bahamas going to do? Bearing in mind that its closest ally historically has been the United States of America, and that ally is at odds with China. When the United States of America comes and says, I want to invest in your country, what's the Bahamas going to do? Knowing that a growing influence in its country in terms of ally is China, and that they are at odds with the United States. What are you going to do? Are you going to say no to China? Are you going to say no to America? Or are we going to be able to develop a policy that first clarifies what the Bahamas' strategic interest is? That's the first thing. See, when you're caught in a conflict, when you're caught in a situation, you got to know, the most important thing for you to know is what do you want? A lot of times we are in conflict and we are arguing and fighting and kicking and stomping, worrying about what the other person is doing and so forth. When we haven't decided yet, what do I want? What do I need done? What is it that I seek in the end? Once you get that clear, now you are in a best position to work through what set of things, what set of decisions best can get me there. What's the Bahamas strategic interest? What is it that we want? What is it we want? And when you're thinking about your strategic interest, you have got to think about it operationally. You have to think about it tactically. You have to think about it in terms of time horizons. What's your medium term? What's your long term interest? You have to think about it in terms of the humanity aspects of it. You have to think about it in environmental terms. You have to think about the existential questions about that. You've got to think about some things that allows you to say concretely, if I get this done, if I do it this way,
I think that I shall be better off or best off. And that's what we have to clarify. We can't start the question with, well, which one of them like us most? We can't start the question with which one of them is the most powerful. We can't start the question with, which one of them my people like so I can make sure it's politically good for me when I start to say things that pander to them. You can't look at it like that. You have to think about it, about what is truly in my strategic interest. And that requires some thoughtfulness, some consideration, sometimes beyond just the political debate. Just beyond people calling these talk shows, talking about, oh, the Chinese stuff is communist and we can't be dealing with them. But you know, America, them ain't really like people like this and so forth. No, you can't deal with it. Like, that's shallow, unthinking, unreasoned, lacking critical thinking kind of stuff. We can't be doing that. We don't have that luxury anymore, man. We don't have the luxury to be playing like we're playing some kind of a Connect Four. We're not playing Connect Four. We're playing chess. We got to be strategic. And so we have to take as studied an approach to it as we can take. But it's a serious issue. And these guys are making the case for how serious that issue is. And they are right. They are right. To my mind, they're right. I mean, that's what I'm saying. I'm saying that to my mind, they're right. You may think differently. We have some text here. This text says, Mr. Laing, preach, we need jobs. This new government only traveling. Now, that's not true. I have not heard anything in terms of foreign investment or job creation. Deputy Prime Minister Chester Cooper has spoken about it. Sorry, he went on a trip to Miami and he made an appeal to investors, so I wouldn't say that. It says, I give them 6 months and these behemoths would be cussing them again. Okay. This text says, great show as usual, China bigger than US and have more economic wealth than and still can beat us in track and field. Man, you're dead wrong. So China may have a bigger population than the US, may have a larger territory than the US, but in terms of economic might and power and wealth, nah, you're dead wrong about that. Just remember, wealth and income ain't the same thing, you know? I don't know, somebody's writing something and I'm not too sure I'm at liberty to read it the way you want me to read it. So you gotta let me know what, if you just write it for me to read or you wrote it for me to say. His text says, how do I find out who owns RBC Bahamas? Well, RBC Bahamas is a subsidiary of RBC, the global company, okay? So Canadian-based RBC, right? And so they own RBC Bahamas. There's nobody here, like some individual investor or someone who owns RBC here. RBC is owned by Royal Bank of Canada. The branch, the subsidiary here is theirs and the branches belong to them. And RBC Global, the global company, is owned 3.5% by BMO Asset Management Inc., 3.49% by 1832 Asset Management LP, 2.9% by TD Asset Management Inc., 2.86% by RBC Global Asset Management Inc., 2.56% by the Vanguard Group Inc., 2.05% by RBC Dominion Securities Inc., 2.05% by Mackenzie Financial Group, 1.87% by FIL Investment Advisors UK Limited, 1.14% by CIBC World Markets Inc., and 1.23% by BMO Asset Management Corp. In other words, almost 50% of RBC is owned by institutional investors. So if you are looking for a person or set of persons individually to be names, don't do that. Because these companies are owned by thousands and thousands, maybe even millions of individual shareholders through institutional investing, okay? So I know we are typically minded to think that you could just go find a person who you could say, oh, he, Zhivargo Laing, owns that are not these companies, man. These global companies, their ownership is diverse, and diverse through many legal entities, mostly through institutional investors, as we call them. So I agree with these gentlemen that it is a strategic issue, not just for the United States of America, but it's a strategic issue for the Bahamas. And I haven't heard anything yet out of the Ministry of Foreign Affairs or from the Minister of Foreign Affairs weighing in on this U.S.-China issue. Maybe it is a strategic decision by them really not to weigh in and simply just kind of stay below the radar in dealing with it. Let them bulls fight and you stay out of the way and don't get trampled upon. That's a consideration too. But I do have another question. Might at some point it be in our interest to have a sit down with a country like the United States of America and talk about a genuine arrangement that might secure more fully the long-term viability of the Bahamas. Now, we could think of that arrangement in terms of the most extensive integration you could get. And that most extensive integration you can get is that the Bahamas becomes a state of the United States of America. That's the most extensive. So you become the 51st US state. Or you could take an approach that says, no, I don't want to do that. I want to just become a territory of the United States of America. You could take that approach too. Or you could decide, no, what if we looked at our economic integration and form a single market and economy with the United States of America? And that way you remain an independent country, but you allow your people, your products, your capital to flow freely throughout the United States, between the United States and the Bahamas, as if it was in essence one economy. There are ways in which it's almost that now, almost, but not quite, because you don't have free flow of people like that. I'm talking about the situation in which an American could come work here and you could go work in America and there's no real impediments to doing so. You could do that. Or you can limit your integration on the grounds of not a single market and economy, but maybe where you have more liberation between the United States and America in terms of trade, where in essence you can go and set up business easily in the United States of America without impediments, and they can come here and set up business easily without impediments. But any number of such considerations to be made that might provide for the Bahamas a more robust economic future, a more viable state, and a more long-term sustainable existence. Imagine in that day we don't do what we need to do to combat climate change, and the sea level continues to rise in a way that essentially means that our very low-lying properties soon becomes at risk of being swallowed by the sea. Where you gonna go, Bahamians? You go to Como Hill? But Como Hill only 200 feet in there. Where are we gonna go? What are we gonna do? But the closest place to run, is the United States of America. You could go to Hispaniola. Are you going to try to go there? Hispaniola, Haiti and the Dominican Republic. You could go there, go south. Where are you going to go? But they're going to be pretty much faced with some of the same issues you're faced with. Where are we going to go? And you certainly know the economic and political situation in those countries. Where are you going to go? If you believe climate change really is real, and you believe, and we believe that it is an existential threat to the Commonwealth of the Bahamas, and we believe that there is a very real possibility in 50, 30, 50, 60, 70 years that this place will be flooded because of sea level rise, who caring about our children and their children, who caring about them would sit down right now and not consider, not think about what we should do in the event that such a thing should happen and could happen? What would we do? Because if these lands become uninhabitable, what are you going to do? What are we going to do? And should we wait for the eventuality to take place before we ponder? What are we going to do? Or might we sit down and have that conversation with the United States of America now? Especially given the concerns that are being raised about the influences the Bahamas could be had from people that are not regarded as allies of the United States of America. What should we do? Do you want to have that conversation with China? Can we have that conversation with China? In the event that we get flooded, China, we want you as a part of your territory, as a part of your state. We want you to fly on us to China so we could take a residence there. What you gonna do? What would you do? These are not theoretical hypotheticals that don't have any real probability attached to them anymore. I mean, that is not true. All around the world and all around the region and right here in this country, we are talking not so much now about climate change possibility. We are talking about climate change adaptabilities, meaning we're saying we no longer are looking at climate change as something that could be preventable, and therefore we need not worry about what we will do when it happens. We are looking at a situation in which climate change is here and we have to adapt, and it's only probably going to get worse. What will we do? It's okay for me to think about, you know what, it don't bother me because I'd probably be dead by that time. But I have kids and they have children and they'll have children and they'll have children. And might I not be, might we not be concerned about what might be their future? Might we not be willing to consider how we might make them better off? Might we not do that by having a conversation with the United States of America? By having a conversation with China? What do you think? You're listening to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. We're going to take a break. When we come back, how about we become the 51st state of the United States of America? We'll be back after this break.
Take a stand, everybody, everybody. Come take my hand, come take my hand. We'll walk this road together through the storm, whatever weather.
We are working to protect our country, our people, and our livelihoods so that we can move forward. The vaccine is safe. The vaccine is easy. The vaccine is essential for our recovery. If we want to rebuild our economy, if we want to get back to our jobs, if we want to get back to our lives, our families, we must do this. Together.
Hello? Yes, it's time. I know, a lot sooner than we thought. Well, that's thanks to those returns from my RF Mutual funds. You know they have some of the best performing funds in the market. Yep, with what I've been earning, I can finally set a date for my product launch. Draft the paperwork, I'm on my way.
Reach your financial goals sooner with RF Mutual Funds. Sign up by November 29th for a chance to win $1,000. Find out more at rfgroup.com. RF, money at work.
I'm not afraid, to take a stand, Everybody. We'll be right back.
become, we become just another one of the U.S. states, part of that great country, that powerful, wealthy country. Somebody texted me and said, was I okay? You'd say, I'm coughing a lot. That wasn't me. I was doing some coughing, but not all together. but thank you for your for your concern. You're listening to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. So glad you could join us. I think we have a call on the line. Go ahead, caller. We're listening to you.
A pleasant. Good afternoon, Mr. Zhivargo Laing.
Hey, Spock. How you doing?
Hey, I hope your family's doing well. You know, the conversation you're having today and the thoughts you are sending out there, these are thoughts that I spoke about years and years ago in regards to China and America and where we sit in the world so-called setup. We are what I would call one of the most beautiful, the best placed little country, Commonwealth of the Bahamas, set up right between the two greatest powers of the world. We are also set up in the Atlantic Ocean, away from everybody where they need shipping to pass to and from us, coming from even from the south to get to the north, from the east to get to the west, and they also use the Panama Canal. But when it came to the population, I say it looks like China has been spreading its wings, sending its people out, because China, unlike America, was planned for every 4 years. China and their double political life, they plan for a 40-year program, from what I've been told and what I've read and what I've seen. They don't plan to just get somebody, put in for 4 years, have an election, and redo it again. They set things out in advance. And when we've been talking about, one time I think an old teacher at Government High, way back in the 70s, told me that the way the Bahamas is set up, other than that hill down in Cat Island or whatever it is, Mount, whatever that is, the highest land in the Bahamas, basically the Bahama Islands are only about 3 to 4 feet above sea level. And with the melting snows and the way we go with climate change and so forth, we could probably, within maybe, not even in your lifetime, maybe our children or grandchildren, we could just disappear into the ocean. But the closest place for us to go, like you said, hey, China can fly everybody from here to China. Because the billions of people, what they got now, they're trying to feed their own people. Our closest land to run would only beat our father figure in the northwest, the great United States of America. That's our only hope, and we beg that they give us grace and say, y'all been friends with us so long, come over here. Because we would have no place to run.
But
I've been watching in the Bahamas, the proliferation of the Chinese everywhere you go now. Bay Street look like a skeleton, a dying city. Everything is moving over the hill, going south, southwest. And if you notice this, and I know you notice it also as you move around town, Chinese businesses, bars, restaurants, supermarkets are jumping up. Every time you go to a corner, there's a new one. And all you see is new Chinese babies and children running around the floor. Now, a friend of mine told me, and that's a little joke before I go. A friend of mine told me he works at the airport. And he's been down there for 20, 40 years, but he never seen no Chinese come in here. He never seen them come on the plane. He don't know how to get here. But we know they're here all the time. They got work permit. They got residency. We don't see them go to no church here. All right,
Sparky man, I'm grateful for the contribution you're making, but I think we get your point. We get your point, but I want us to move on to that larger discussion. But I appreciate your calling. Appreciate it. I don't want us to have a discussion about, you know, the Chinese as something bad. The Americans are something good, or the Americans are something good, and the Chinese are something bad. This is not about them. This is about us. This is about what is in our interest, because we're not going to do anything about, we're not going to get rid of the United States of America as a force in the world, nor are we going to get rid of the Chinese as a force in the world. They have been and have done good for us in ways. There have been some negatives too, but they have been good. So what we're talking about is how we clarify what our issue is and how in a big strategic way we deal with that. I'm not don't want to get caught up in what the Chinese on the ground doing or not doing in that way. That's a different discussion to be had, maybe important to some people for sure, but that's not the one that I want to have today. We have a number of texts here that I want to read. This text says, join the Trumpists who won't give DC or Puerto Rico statehood, so no real representation, only more in their favor. Well, if you negotiate to be a Puerto Rico or a DC, yeah, you're right, that could be you, or you could do something different. I mean, but who knows, right? That, you see, the problem with this point here is, now you're saying, as if you are questioning join the United States. Okay, that's that. What's the alternative now? So this person's alternative, I believe, if I am correctly reading something they sent to me, is that what you do is let's elevate our structures so that we can endure the rising sea levels. Yeah, that's a possibility. That's a possibility. But that presumes you know how that sea level rise is going to go. That presumes that it's going to go in such a way that you could raise oil and elevate all your stuff because you're only going to have intermittent flooding. But if the level rises that you go under the water, as we are told Atlantis did, what does that mean? How high is it going to rise? Do you know? And if it rises high enough, 5, 6, 7 feet, and stays at that level, we're going to become a boat country? And you want to live in a boat country like that? Oh, yeah, okay, I mean, I understand. I can tell you one thing. I can't conceive myself living in a boat country. I can't. I just don't see that. I don't see that. I want to live on dry land. Maybe because God took the earth and elevated it above the sea so he could put the human beings on dry land. Maybe that's just in my nature. So, yeah. So I don't know. My question is, I'm not directing us in one way or the other. I'm just asking. Okay, if not the United States, what's the alternative? We have to think through this. Not emotionally. We have to think through it rationally and strategically. That's the issue that confronts us. This text says, Mr. Laing, I don't always get the opportunity to listen to your show because of my work obligations, but I'm glad I got a chance today. This is an important discussion you are presenting today. Keep up the good work. Thank you very much. It is a very important discussion. I haven't just started thinking about this. I have had this discussion with some very knowledgeable and intelligent people. We've been looking at this thing about what you do and what integration opportunities might exist for us in the world, and so forth and so forth, so that we might be serious, sensible people about our future. Right? Seriously sensible. That's the question. Can you do that? And are you willing and prepared to do that, to be very serious and sensible about your future? And when you're thinking about your future, you don't get the ideal all the time. You don't get to have it your way. And the United States of America, I'm sorry, is not a Trumpist country. They have segments of that population that is certainly supportive of Donald Trump and what have you, but Joe Biden is not Donald Trump. Barack Obama wasn't Donald Trump. Bill Clinton wasn't Donald Trump. Ronald Reagan wasn't Donald Trump. All right, so let's not pretend that. This text says, we have some text here, I'll read those for you. This text says, Biden caused all this. Just trying to spite Trump. Biden is a baby in comparison. Oh, wow. Okay. This text says, China and Cuba is going to take over the Bahamas. This has been prophesied since 1992. Why are y'all sleeping? China's desire is to rape our waters. Okay. This text says, text for Z Live says, anonymous question. During the state of emergency, you think it's legal for banks to enforce penalties and threats of taking action against non-paying loan holders on furlough who has no income, also applying interest to those loans? Absolutely, it's legal. It's in accordance with their contract. In the contract doesn't say, in the event you get laid off or fired, I don't get to ask you for payment anymore. I don't get to have interest. None of that is in the contract. All right, adults sign those contracts. Read the contract, read the mortgage contract. All right? This text says, Mr. Laing, the Chinese are not going anywhere. They have the money, they have the US jittery, and they are not scared. Don't forget, China has one of the largest standing armies in the world. So they are a military giant. Man, the Chinese doing what they have to do in our region, buy them out. It's a crime against humanity. The evidence is there, okay? What do you do, though? What are you saying? You're saying the government of the Bahamas should say, listen, China, don't bring none of y'all businessmen here. We're not taking no money from y'all. There's human rights violations, so y'all, they're not... Let me leave that to today. So just like Brazil, just like Chile, or Slovan Milosevic, I don't know what that is, or Saddam Hussein, you will be charged for crimes against humanity. Defend you or stop trying to push Pintard on us. We love Brave Davis. C-Line, you have a problem with the Orthodox team? What? You've been listening to this show? This text says, well, all Americans need to do is march or do better than the investment of Chinese. You're absolutely right. It's simple. America needs to invest its money in the Bahamas and stop criticizing other countries. Absolutely right. Step up. But that's what the article is arguing. Step up. Tell America, step up. So why America don't invest in the Bahamas and stop complaining about people who are? Mm-hmm. So we don't even have no American banks here. Why don't they invest here? I would like us to be a U.S. territory, says that person. See, everybody don't think alike. Everybody ain't the same. Some people hate that idea. Some people don't have no problems with it. Boy, just throwing it out there. Actually, I'm not just throwing it out there. I'm talking about strategically speaking. It's a serious consideration. You can't believe in climate change. You can't believe in the possibility of what climate change poses to small island states like ours. We can't have our prime minister go. To prime ministers, go away. Tell people how serious climate change is. Beg them to do something about it. And say at the same time that climate change threatens to raise sea levels by about 2 feet. And if it does, it can wipe out almost all of moms. We can't be serious about applauding these prime ministers when they go and do these things and then turn around and think it's not an important discussion about what is you going to do if you have sea level rise that floods the country. We can't be serious. We have to consider that. If that is a possibility, then a planning society, a planning nation would want to say, if such a thing should happen, God forbid, here is how I should take care of our babies. Here's how I should take care of our women. Here's how I should take care of our children. Here is how I should take care of our people. You can't be serious and not raise that question. Let me tell you something, in the Bahamas, needs to get in a situation where it's got people sitting around just thinking up stuff. That's it, just thinking up stuff. That's what NASA and them do, you know. They got people sitting around, all they're doing is stinking up stuff. They're looking at, what if you do it this way? What if that happened? What if this happened? That's how you get innovation. That's how you get creativity. It's just thinking up stuff. You're thinking about eventualities that you hadn't thought of before. I drive around the Bahamas. And I see things and I think, what if that particular building got on fire? I don't want to call them because I don't even want to put it in your head. I think, what would if that community got on fire? I think, what if a terrorist attacked that particular building or those buildings? What if a group of hostage takers decided to take hostage those particular set of people? How might we prepare to prevent that? How might we prepare, what might we do to respond to it? Might be likely, but it's possible. And that's what strategic thinking is about. It's about trying to anticipate possibilities and then going to try to do something about it. This text says, the next 30 years, the U.S. will remain in political turmoil. I wish I was wrong, but due to Republican redistricting, voter suppression, and continuance of unrepresentative Senate, this is going to be a great unstable period. I agree with you. In fact, that might make any possibility of having a negotiation about this matter quite difficult. So I agree with you. Says, I agree that great strategic thought must go into climate solutions. We have a call on the line. Go ahead, caller. We're listening to you.
Yes, good afternoon. Good evening, Mr. Laing.
Hey, how you doing, man? You right?
Yes, everything's wonderful. Mr. Laing, you're on point today because, like you said, if the Prime Minister and all of those world leaders are talking about climate change and sea level rise, I think our Prime Minister and the Bahamian people should be thinking about if the eventuality happens. And I don't know which islands in the Bahamas, if the sea level rises like about 2 feet, will it swallow up the entire Bahamas or some of the islands can withstand that rise? Because, I mean, we need to start planning, let's say, which islands...
Well, the question would be whether it would rise and recede, right? Because if the rise is permanent, there are great many islands that would have many parts of it or maybe entire islands that would be flooded. Maybe right. Some islands would have some parts of it not flooded, but really, in essence, the biggest challenge is New Providence and Grand Bahama and those with the most populations, hey? Because let's say, like, you are flooding in the northern Bahamas, no flooding in the central Bahamas and northern Bahamas, but you're flooding in the southern Bahamas, and it's inconceivable how that would happen. But if you did, you could at least move that small group of people into those right. central and northern islands. Eh? But if you have right. that kind of flooding in the north and central islands, what we can do?
With your knowledge, right? Mm-hmm. How many islands in the Bahamas that are elevated in terms of
Not elevated beyond a 2 feet, 3 feet permanent rise in the sea level, though. Because if you think about what happens in New Providence during hurricanes, think about what happens during heavy rains.
That's true.
Just think about it for a minute, yeah, right?
Right. And I heard you mention being a sea, we call it boat people. That's impossible yeah. because they'll be in the hurricane zone. So that's out of the question right there.
Think about becoming of what would have to happen to become a sea nation. First of all, most of these homes that people have already invested in, who can break them down and elevate them? Where the money coming from for that? From them people now, the personal people.
But right. Think about it, Mr. Laing, in the hurricane zone. So, I mean, one hurricane, you're right. We talk about elevated homes. Right. That'd be the only road to know there. So.
You're absolutely right. So you are drawing out the complexity of trying to think about continuing to be here in a elevated sea flooded scenario.
And with being the boat people, what our economy would be like. Because I mean, exactly. You can't be on. I don't understand that part of you.
So, remember, brother, listen, man, go ahead, go to the head of the class. Go to the head of the class. Because you're absolutely right.
I don't know.
Right? I want you but you know what? Let's just think about it this way. Do you have kids?
Yes.
Okay, I have a 13-year-old, right? But I have, at one point, a lot of my kids were like, you know, they're 7, 8, 9, and them kind of thing. Can you imagine having to manage them in a sea, a boat country?
I watch it on YouTube, those countries, those persons who part of the country live on the sea, and how I don't understand how they survive there.
Well, there's a place in Nigeria where, in Lagos, where it happens, and I've been there, and I can tell you, I mean, the kids are happy because it's a life they've come to be accustomed to. But right. if you ask their parents if they would get a better life for them, they would want it.
Exactly. I watch it on YouTube. So
they're
not there YouTube.
Because they want to be there. They're because they have to be, they feel.
And right now, we are challenged in terms of, like you mentioned, Freeport. I mean, during the hurricane or in Nassau, during heavy rain downpour, a certain part of Nassau is really underwater. So nowhere for the water to go. So, I mean, like, this is a serious situation.
My friend, I'm standing in my house in Freeport right now, and it's been renovated because in the hurricane, the same place right here had 5 feet of water.
Wow.
5 feet of water. I have a two-story. My neighbors fled their homes, broke open my house, broke my glass screen so that they can go and secure themselves against the hurricane in my second floor.
Wow. Wow.
Okay, it's a serious thing.
Yeah, it's very serious. So I think we should start planning. We need to start planning. I mean, talking with other countries, we must. Because we need a strategic plan in case something happens. We need a plan.
Yeah.
Even if it don't come true, if it don't happen, at least you have a plan on paper.
You're absolutely right. I appreciate it, man. Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, you're listening to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. We'll take our final break, and when we come back, we will continue our discussions. We'll be back after this break.
BK Nassau and Pepsi want to bring you a fun day on us. Upgrade your favorite combo and get a chance to win great prizes like staycations at Atlantis or Bahamar, powerboat adventure excursions, or a Blue Lagoon dolphin encounter. You can also win a relaxing day at Sandy Toes or a VIP movie experience at Fusion. Upgrade your combo at any of BK Nassau's 7 locations and enter to win at BK242.com. Win fun days with Pepsi and Burger King, where taste is king.
Sheila, you okay? I see smoke coming from your window.
Chad, Johnny Moe's burning down the house frying chicken.
Your kitchen is a mess. You have insurance?
If I have insurance, I pulled my phone out, pulled up the Royal Star Insurance app, and in no time, I was on live chat with RSA rep. Sent pics of the damage, filed my claim on the spot.
Wow, I don't think my insurance got that kind of app.
You gotta go to RSA for that.
Download the RSA app today. Live chat available weekdays 9 to 5.
Do you want to travel this holiday season? Don't want to miss out on those door buster deals? Haven't gotten your COVID-19 vaccine yet? The Johnson & Johnson vaccine may be just what you need. It's one and done and fully vaccinated. For now, just one jab of this vaccine, and 2 weeks later, you're fully vaccinated and ready to shop. This message has been brought to you by the Ministry of Health and this radio station.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
I'm not afraid, I'm not afraid to take a stand.
Back, ladies and gentlemen, to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. I'm so glad you could join us here today on Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM on this beautiful Thursday afternoon, where we have been talking about the strategic issue confronting the Bahamas insofar as its relationship with the United States and China is concerned, and how that relationship is going to play out in the wake of the tensions that exist between those two countries. Insofar as I'm concerned, I don't see any reason to put impediments to Chinese investments in the Bahamas at all. However, I at the same time think that it does make sense for the Bahamas to court a greater engagement with the United States of America. We take for granted that relationship. It is an important relationship. It is a relationship in which the mutual interests of both countries have not been fully explored. It is a relationship in which there are enormous benefits to be gained from by both countries. And it is a relationship that stands to put us in the best situation to secure our future going forward if we can manage the relationship properly. And notwithstanding political challenges confronted by that country, the United States of America, one of its great abilities has been its capacity to bounce back even from its own failure and internal weaknesses. It's a learning country, and it has to be because its own peoples, its own press, will turn their eyes and the light on their own selves and demonstrate and show with great rigor their own flaws. When you go and pretend to the world that you are so perfect and all that kind of stuff and don't allow the light to shine on your own weaknesses, you can't grow and be strong because you don't hold yourself up to scrutiny. Now, there is an extent to which China is like that. China does not turn the light on itself. And that's why, notwithstanding the progress China has made, it's not the great. I want you to consider that China was a more exemplary country insofar as human rights issues are concerned, insofar as what we might call democratic values are concerned. Even though it would be a different place in the world, it would be a different place. Now, mind you, they choose their own destiny. They choose their own way of life and being. So ain't nothing I can do about it, but I'm just saying. So the Bahamas, I don't think, should have a situation in which it is putting impediments to Chinese investments, even though I believe that the Bahamas should treat its foreign direct investment initiatives like a portfolio in which the investments reflect a certain balance intended to give it resiliency. And so that if there isn't too much of a concentration on the part of any country, and if you have a leaning in which you are prepared to shift the balance in favor of, well, you do that in favor of the United States of America for historic, for proximal and geostrategic reasons and ideological reasons, you know, but we can have a portfolio of investments that are balanced across the globe. So you have European investments of a certain percentage, you have U.S. Investments of a certain percentage, you have Chinese or Asian of a certain percentage, and you try to balance out your portfolio in that way and direct them to the extent possible in areas that represent the most benefits to you as a nation. But at the same time, look strategically at your long-term interests being served in light of these environmental concerns that have existential implications for the country. And so, you know, it requires us, this isn't a conversation where we get up in the House of Assembly and just go pop off of thoughts. You got to think through this. You have a call on the line. Go ahead, caller. We're listening to you.
Yes. How are you doing? Good afternoon, Mr. Laing, Alan Johnson.
Hey, how you doing, man?
Yeah, Mr. Laing, I just want to say that we should be making arrangements to become climate refugees. This is not a if. It's a will be. I mean, there are some steps we have to take, but we're not having that type of discussion. And let me tell you why. If you look at the goals that is made at COP 26, and if they meet 100% of the goals of the promises that they have made, they will still not get us to 2.5% of global warming by 2100. The problem is that 2 degrees of warming, it eliminates the Bahamas and many of the coastal communities in the U.S. and other places. And so I'm literally saying that forget the talk and it's the science.
I'm on the radio today.
Yeah? So the science says 100% of the goals of COP 26 will not get us to even 2.5 degrees. And at 2 degrees, the Bahamas is gone. So unless something changes into the future, we can make arrangements to shore up our existence as technology and information evolve. But in the absence of that, we won't be here, plain and simple.
Yeah, and the thing about it is, if we are proactive about it, we don't have to be so much climate refugees. We can make strategic decisions about our relationship with others in such a way as basically we may just be relocating within a common zone.
Yeah, let me give you an example, right? We often talk about this aragonite and sand and everything. There's something called the monopoly of the seas. No matter what, the Bahamas will retain, as long as we have landmass, we'll retain this place called the territorial zone and exclusive economic zones. We can look at our current territorial zones, and just like China and other places do, as we shore up our existing islands, we could build small islands that meet the requirements for habitability, which will extend our economic zone as well as our territorial zone. And what it does, it puts us in a strategic position to be able to negotiate with the giants such as America and everything else. Because even if we move 1 meter, we can build to meet the global definition above that 1 meter with our artificial islands, which then holds credibility. So as long as the country itself maintains its territorial zone and its economic exclusive economic zone, we could be in a position to negotiate whatever we want in the fact of even having to locate someplace else, because we will still maintain our requirements for being behemoths and everything else. So we just not adding, you know, we are reactive as opposed to being proactive in what we need to do and how we need to build into the future. And I see means of us actually, you know, if we can't sit at the table, I think that we're in a position to build another table and invite them to sit with us. But we just keep doing the same thing, expecting different results.
Well, what you say in terms of building upward on some of those islands makes perfect sense. But you and I know it ain't going to happen without some substantial investment, right? Because Dubai and them have to do so. So you're going to have to find participation.
No, I'm saying to you is, having one of the most, if you look at the ocean monopoly type game, we have the resources that we can actually sit at the table even for negotiation of it. Not just talk about mining and giving every behemoth 100,000. I'm talking about real talk about the resources that we have, because the world as it moves towards these issues we're having needs the resources we have, even from the feeding environment of our nursery. So just have to look at cooperative to simply say, we're not begging you for anything, and you're not begging us for anything, but we will sit to the table as equals. And we just have to redefine what it is we do and how we do it.
I appreciate it, man.
Thank you so much.
Thanks a lot. Appreciate it. This Texas is a sea nation. Most of us can't even swim, much less fish. Yeah, that's true. Sis Tex, getting ready to close out. We have a couple of texts here. This text says, good day, Mr. Lang. New York and Delaware has the same, and in some cases, more restrictions on voting as the laws that just passed in Virginia. And they have Democratic leadership. So to agree that the Republicans are suppressing the vote isn't true. You need ID for everything else. What's wrong? Okay. Defending the Republicans. Okay. All right, ladies and gentlemen, I'm so glad that you were able to join us today. We'll continue these kinds of discussions as we move along, hoping to stretch our minds in the direction of how we might better prepare ourselves for whatever eventually happens in the world and that impacts upon our country. So I trust you have a wonderful evening. Nahaja Black is up next. God bless you. You've been listening to Z-Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. We'll talk to you again tomorrow. Take care. Everybody.